Good morning and welcome to you all for this service of morning prayer on Saturday the 10th of July. It's good to have your company this morning. O Lord, open our lips and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. Blessed are you, creator of all. To you be praise and glory forever. As your dawn renews the face of the earth, bringing light and life to all creation. May we rejoice in this day you have made. As we awake refreshed from the depths of sleep, open our eyes to behold your presence and strengthen our hands to do your will, that the world may rejoice and give you praise. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God for ever. The night has passed and the day lies open before us, so let us pray with one heart and mind. As we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and for ever. Amen. Our psalm appointed for this morning is Psalm 121. The Lord shall keep you from all evil. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where is my help to come? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not suffer your foot to stumble. He who watches over you will not sleep. Behold, he who keeps watch over Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord himself watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand, so that the sun shall not strike you by day, neither the moon by night. The Lord shall keep you from all evil. It is he who shall keep your soul. The Lord shall keep watch over your going out and your coming in, from this time forth for evermore. The Lord shall keep you from all evil. Lord, ever watchful and faithful, we look to you to be our defence, and we lift our hearts to know your help, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be for ever. Amen. Our first reading this morning, we continue to hear from the book of Ezekiel, chapter 9. Then he cried in my hearing with a loud voice, saying, "Draw near, you executioners of the city, each with his destroying weapon in his hand." And six men came from the direction of the upper gate, which faces north, each with his weapon for slaughter in his hand. Among them was a man clothed in linen, with a writing case at his side. They went in and stood beside the bronze altar. Now the glory of the God of Israel had gone up from the cherub on which it rested to the threshold of the house. The Lord called to the man clothed in linen, who had the writing case at his side, and said to him, "Go through the city, through Jerusalem, and put a mark on the foreheads of those who sigh and groan over all the abominations that are committed in it." To the others he said in my hearing, "Pass through the city after him and kill. Your eye shall not spare, and you shall show no pity. Cut down old men, young men, and young women, little children and women, but touch no one who has the mark, and begin at my sanctuary." So they began with the elders who were in front of the house, and he said to them, "Defile the house and fill the courts of the slain. Go." So they went out and killed in the city. While they were killing, and I was left alone, I fell prostrate on my face and cried out, "O Lord God, will you destroy all who remain of Israel, as you pour out your wrath upon Jerusalem?" He said to me, "The guilt of the house of Israel and Judah is exceedingly great. The land is full of bloodshed, and the city full of perversity. As they say, the Lord has forsaken the land, and the Lord does not see. As for me, my eye will not spare, nor will I have pity, but I will bring down their deeds upon their heads." Then the man clothed in linen, with the writing case at his side, brought back word, saying, "I have done as you commanded me." Here ends our first reading. Song of Jerusalem, our Mother. Thus says our God, "I will comfort you. You shall see and your heart shall rejoice." Rejoice with Jerusalem and be glad for her, all you who love her, says the Lord. Rejoice with her in joy, all you who mourn over her, that you may drink deeply with delight from her consoling breast. For thus says our God, you shall be nursed and carried on her arm. As a mother comforts her children, so I will comfort you. You shall see and your heart shall rejoice. You shall flourish like the grass of the fields. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be for ever. Amen. Thus says our God, I will comfort you. You shall see, and your heart shall rejoice. Our second reading is taken from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, today reading chapter 5. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this tent we groan, longing to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling, if indeed when we have taken it off, we will not be found naked. For while we were still in this tent, we groan under our burden, because we wish not to be unclothed, but to be further clothed, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. He who has prepared us for this very thing is God, who has given us the Spirit as a guarantee. So we are always confident, even though we know that while we were at home in the body, we are away from the Lord, for we walk by faith, not by sight. Yes, we do have confidence, and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please him. For all of us must appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each may receive recompense for what has been done in the body, whether good or evil. Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we try to persuade others, but we ourselves are well known to God, and I hope that we are also well known to your consciences. We are not commending ourselves to you again, but giving you an opportunity to boast about us, so that you may be able to answer those who boast in outward appearance and not in the heart. For if we are beside ourselves, it is for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ urges us on, because we are convinced that one has died for all, therefore all have died, and he died for all, so that those who live might live no longer for themselves, but for him who died and was raised for them. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting the message of reconciliation to us. So we are ambassadors for Christ, since God is making his appeal through us. We entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Here ends our second reading. The Benedictus. Shine on us, O God, who dwell in darkness, and guide us into the way of peace. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who has come to his people and set them free. He has raised up for us a mighty Saviour, born of the house of his servant David. Through his holy prophets, God promised of old to save us from our enemies, from the hands of all that hate us, to show mercy to our ancestors, and to remember his holy covenant. This was the oath God swore to our father Abraham, to set us free from the hands of our enemies, free to worship him without fear, holy and righteous in his sight all the days of our life. A new child shall be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his way, to give his people knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of all their sins. In the tender compassion of our God, the dawn from on high shall break upon us, to shine on those who dwell in darkness and the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be for ever. Amen. Shine on us, O God, who dwell in darkness, and guide us into the way of peace. So let us pray. So we thank you, Lord, for bringing us safely to the beginning of this day. We give thanks for all that we have done this past week, and we commit this day to you, with all that it will bring us, the people we will meet with, work we will do, and rest we will enjoy. At this time, we pray especially for the General Synod, meeting remotely this weekend, for the work that they will do, for the decisions that they will make on behalf of the Church as a whole. We pray for those who've served on the General Synod these past 6 years, as their term of office comes to an end this weekend. And we pray for all those who may be thinking about standing for election in the coming weeks, for the new General Synod, which will be commissioned in November, and for the work that they will be undertaking on behalf of the Church as a whole. We pray for the Archbishops of Canterbury and York as they lead the Synod and lead the Church across the world. Locally, we pray for our own bishops, for Bishop Julian, Bishop Philip and Bishop Jill, and for the work that they do across our diocese. We pray for our archdeacons, Mark and David, and for Peter, the Dean at the Cathedral, for all the roles of leadership that they have in guiding us through these unusual times. We pray for all those churches which are contemplating unlocking as restrictions are lifted, and about how we go about doing that to balance being able to worship fully, but also being able to keep people safe and feel comfortable attending our services. We pray for the work of PCCs and church wardens, particularly in this role. This weekend, we pray for all those who will be meeting together for worship, for services that will be held both in person and online. And we pray most especially for the celebrations of two weddings that we have at St. Peter's, Marcus and Jessica today, and Andrew and Lucy tomorrow. Lord, we ask for your blessing to be upon them and to be upon their marriages. We pray that you would guide and strengthen them as they move through the years together. And we pray for all who will be celebrating with them. As we pray for our world, we know that there are many who dwell in darkness and fear today. For those who feel weighed down by the weight of poverty, those who are caught up in modern day slavery, those who are struggling in life. Lord, we pray for them, that we who have so much may always be mindful and try to do what we can to help those in our world who have not. We pray for those who are longing for peace and that reconciliation we hear about in our readings today. For that bringing together of your people, Lord, rather than dividing them. That we would see beyond what is right in front of us to the person and the people that we know. We pray especially for the leaders of nations at this time. We pray, Lord, that you would bless them with your gifts of wisdom and discernment, especially in all the decisions that they take on our behalf. We pray for all those who are at the forefront of the fight against this global pandemic, for the decisions that need to be made about restrictions, about guidance, about guidelines, and about how people can be helped in countries, especially where there is a high spike in cases. We give you thanks, Lord, for the vaccination programme, and we pray that it continues to be rolled out so that more and more countries may benefit from it. We pray for all those who are our key workers, for those who will be going out to work today and those working from home. We pray for those who are preparing to reopen businesses in the next couple of weeks, those who are looking forward to being back at work, but also those who feel very anxious about it. We continue to pray for those who are unable to work, and especially for those who have lost their employment during this time. We pray for our young people as they enjoy their weekend from school. We pray that they would have time to rest and relax, and time also to play. So we pray most especially, Lord, as we have for so long, in thanksgiving for the work of all those who work in the medical profession and health service, across its many different roles, responsibilities and spheres. We pray for our hospitals, for those who work within them, and those who sadly find themselves in hospital at this time. We pray for those who work on the front line, and for those who work very much behind the scenes, for those who work day to day, those who are involved in saving lives, and for those who work in the emergency services. We continue to pray also for our hospital chaplains, for the pastoral care and support that they provide to so many. We pray for our hospices and hospice at home, for care homes and sheltered accommodation, nursing and residential homes, and especially for those who will be able to visit family today. We pray for carers and all those who work in people's homes and out in the community, providing the much needed support to them. We continue to pray for our GP surgeries, pharmacies and health centres, and for all those places that are vaccination hubs today. We pray for those who will be administering vaccines and those who will be receiving them. And so we bring to you, Lord, those we know who are unwell at this time, those who long for healing and wholeness and an end to their pain and concerns. We bring before you, Lord, David, Alan, John, Jeff, Jim, Elaine, Kath and her family, Christine, Sister Catherine, Douglas, Steve, Joanna, Jean, Jane, Eric, Andrew, Judy, Helen, Cilla, Linda, Cheryl, Joyce, Audrey, Alan, Irene and Terry, Lisa, Roman and Hunter, Tracy and Myrtle. Lord, we pray for them and all those that we name in our hearts and minds today. And so we pray for those who have died. We pray for those who have died this past night, for those who have died recently, those whose funerals will take place this coming week, and those whose anniversaries occur at this time. Lord, we ask that you would surround those who mourn with your loving and comforting arms, that you would raise them up so as they may see the hope of the resurrection and the promised gift of eternal life. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is governed and sanctified, hear our prayer which we offer for all your faithful people, that in their vocation and ministry they may serve you in holiness and truth, to the glory of your name, through our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and for ever. Amen. And as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and for ever. Amen. The Lord bless us and preserve us from all evil, and keep us in eternal life. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thank you very much for joining me for this service of morning prayer today. We have a service of evening prayer at 5 o'clock. We have our usual live stream service at 10:30 tomorrow. And then there will be no live stream services until Thursday morning, when we will be back with morning prayer at 9 o'clock. The details will come up on our Facebook page as to when we are meeting together. So hopefully I may see you this evening for our service then. And in the meantime, I hope you have a good day. Take care, stay safe, look after yourselves, and you remain, as always, in my prayers.